to embrace the web technology. The web has certainly changed GIS. We know GIS was invented in 1962 by our father, Roger Hopkinson. In 1990, the web was invented by the father of the web, Tim Berners-Lee. In 1993, Web GIS came to life. It was born in the city lab by a company called Xerox, which at that time had this parallel research center. Well, we did some research on human-computer interaction. We developed this map viewer in the browser. It looks very cool today. But it demonstrated the main advantage of delivering GIS over the web. But with this application, it's simple, but it has a global reach. Anybody can see this application, also because of this application. It can support many users on the internet. It has a better cross-platform capability. You can use this on Mac, Windows, other platforms. It can custom less and more custom. People are supporting one a few thousand users.
So if I give a definition of Web GIS, what is Web GIS? It's the components they communicate with each other using web technology, more specifically, it's URL. URL, this means here, the clients can find the server as headers of the server. With HTTP, the client can call the server. So the HTML is usually the way to prepare a result. Our Web GIS was invented, was soon adopted by many, many organizations with a lot of applications. For me, I work at GISAB Professional Services, where we work on contracts and for the government. You here, I guess, you're working in business. Web GIS can also be used for advertisement, or marketing, or customer service, or business analysis. So you have to use the GISAB business analysis, you know, for research, for our daily life. Web GIS can be part of our life. Public information service, the model medical law. I just cannot think of anything better than a web map to show you in the public where the sex offenders were convicted and where they live. With this web map, you can just type in address where kids swear and find under any sex offenders living nearby. This can prevent many things from happening. Recovery.gov, this is a program we developed 6 years ago, 7 years ago. With this web application, you can clearly see where the government cannot stimulus funding was spent. Which state, which county, which organization, we see how much money, how it is spent funding. This keeps the government transparent and prevents an effective fight for government corruption. This is the new version we developed in 2010 in JavaScript. The previous version was developed in Flask. In the map, table, chart, tree map, tree chart. Web GIS can also be used for distance support. This is one of my favorite projects. We developed in 2005 for Lolita University Medical Center. So, the director of the Lolita Medical Center in EMS, Emergency Medical Service, he came to us. He said one day he was on a nursing helicopter on a highway. Not far from him, there was show them where our resources are, our helicopters and ambulances. What's the traffic condition? Should I dispatch a helicopter or should I dispatch an ambulance? And which hospital should I dispatch to your transport station? So, some hospitals, it's emergency room maybe. So we developed this application where you can see the helicopters, the ambulances, the hospital status. If the hospital is yellow, it's my emergency room is emergency room, do not send me more patients. Or it's green, yes, I can accept more patients. The highly effective information at that time we got from the health transfer machine that I'm using the green flag with the yellow flag class. Our incidents. So we got all information in real time. How do we do this? We got a hospital status. Can I accept patients? From California, from Southern California Hospital Association, we had a server give this information. We got it every 2 minutes. High speed and close at that time, 2005, almost 10 years ago. We read that from California, the economy transportation. High incidents. We read that from California Highway Patrol. Ground vehicles and helicopters, we read their location information from a company called GISAB, where they sell GPS on those units. We read this information to sources every 2 minutes or every 5 seconds. Together and then we will base maps and other services to create this one application where at a glance you can see where your resources are, where patients are. This helps simplify. So we're going to be talking about more applications in the talk about the technologies. So since Web GIS was invented in 1993, the technology has gone through a lot of transitions. From websites to web services, switch your frontiers, web services extended by web APIs, and information flows from one way to two ways, from the local servers to the cloud, from the wire to wireless, mobile, what I just mentioned, from 2D to 3D to 4D. I'll talk about more of this in later videos. For web services, may sound something very complicated in your jargon. But let me reflect on this project I did in 2001. This project was called Enterprise GIS for HUB, for US Housing and Urban Development. dynamically. Our data will be always in sync. They keep their data, next time we request a map or they query, we always get the data there. For us, we don't have to have that huge database. It's saving money for us. The providers, you know, always in control state. They say, I can give you service. They don't want to say, you need any money. I can set up some passwords. So by hosting web services, it's more flexible. The subject is more flexible. It's more efficient. If we don't use such today, I guess $300,000 can get started that day. So we instead of 200 days a day, so web services. The appropriate interface is hosted by the server. You can provide server-side management capabilities, data anomaly capabilities. They're actually more, they're not many web services, many types of web services. 2D map services, that's what we see, 2D maps. The 3D map services, image services, geometry services, feature services, search, routing, key processing, and kind of other services. So today, we're going to develop web GIS applications for mobile products. So you have RTS online or on servers. You are just public services. So you can watch it like this. You have a lab login, and I see you publish it as a service. You have a model for Python script, publish that as a key processing service. Then on the browser side, you're just calling the services, putting together, matching up. So this web services and the mashup, this idea is very interesting. You think about this USGS, I'm serving the base maps. This EPA, I'm serving the environmental data maps. In another organization, can combine these two web services to create another service that will be shared and used by another application. Web GIS becomes N-tiers, not just data tier, not data tier here, but another tier. So you have the web GIS becomes N-tiers. Today, if you go to ESRI's conferences or workshops, you put a lot of things, web APIs, SDKs. So why do we need them? Using web services are so good, why do we need web APIs and SDKs? Well, web services is scoping on the server side. Say, one of the times I'm writing an application, I say, hey server, give me a map. The server receives this request, web service, say, hey, got your request, I'll give you data, I give you a map. Give to you. Server only. Someone does this, see the map. But what should it do with it with this map? Right? You have to put the map somewhere on your user interface. You have to monitor users' mouse move, mouse click, to do something more, something else. So this user interaction is handled by the web APIs and by SDKs. So you don't write deal with web services directly. You use web APIs and SDKs, which communicate with the services. They simplify your job. You don't have to monitor a web app code to call the server to interact with users. So today, ESR's most popular programming language, I think today, is web APIs and SDKs, especially JavaScript. What was the case of Java Objective-C? So in that one application, one demo is needed. I put my data into the DAW, that's into the web service. With RTS one, I create one application with the template, that's platform as a service. After some application is created, it's hosted at RTS one as software as a service. So that's what we do. RTS provides many templates. And for templates, you saw that. A lot more templates. This one is the spot template. You can compare two web maps.
is going to spy glass. You can see the current, the previous written time, same area of the mass. This animation over time, you can see the pattern over time changing. So after this one, you will take the ESL workshops, conferences, you know that's the top words, top keywords you learn from conferences. Indeed, it's been adopted quickly. You can see the USFS, USDA, POM, FDA, FEMA, EPA, NOAA are all adopting this technology platform. This is one company, but a very open mind company. It's also using ArcGIS Online's templates to manage data to create applications. One project I did with Indonesia, you're using ArcGIS Online for your own, instead of ArcGIS Online for your home, you run your own country. It's called Port ArcGIS Online. This whole implementation was $25 million. The other trend that I want to talk about is VGI, Volunteer Geographic Information. This term was coined by Marx professor, Professor Guitel, 2007. But we did a project much earlier than Guitel. We did this project in 2003, 4 years before Guitel coined this term. We did a project for this law, this act called NEPA, National Environmental Policy Act. According to this act, government duty project, you have to have something called, you have to have this process called public clearing. You collect comments from the public. Traditionally, this has been done using public hearing conference. Today, we can call it a much better process to be online. You don't have to go to this conference. We can just sit at home. View the planning documents and submit your comments. So based on this purpose, we worked with the UN, with the USFS. We developed this ePlanning project. This was done in 2003. You can see the scenery is not great. But the idea is there. Citizens can stay at home, you can see the planning document, the planning map, click on a piece of land. Can see the planned use of that area. And you can submit your comments online, just at your home. You can redline on that, write your comments here, no fishing here. And put your comments here and submit it. You don't have to fax it, you have to send a letter. It's much cheaper process for the citizens. Much cheaper for the government to process the comments. So according to the law, government has to respond to every public comments, every one comment. So within the process, it's much cheaper, much more efficient. Today we're having a lot more products with this idea of a lot more products. Behind this kind of products, we're using feature service technology. So all this information, all this application done with the VGI, they are all done using something called a feature service. I call that the first information flow. Because when we're reading that service, we're getting data from the server. It's from the server to the clients, top down. With the feature service, we're going bottom up. We're cutting data from the field, from the consumers, users to the server, and save that data to the service database. That's how feature service. I was going to do that, I guess, but we don't have all the time. It's also very easy to do. With Excel, so you have an Excel file. Then you can upload this Excel file into our case online, subscription. And there is an option called create feature service. You can create this in a few things. When you have a service created, then you can with web, user experience design is very important. In our group, and I work at GISAB services, in our department, we just formed the user experience group. Well, the small group certainly got overloaded with the department. not patient. Don't make me wait. I don't have to wait. Make it simple. Don't even think. I don't want to think about which button to click. Don't give me too many buttons. Don't be too complicated. Easy. Really enjoy it and have some fun. Many ways to transmission user experience. Now the one way is called using voice control. That's really good. And how can you use it to be more favorable to use our applications, use our devices. So what GIS as a conclusion, what GIS has come through, what GIS is 21 years old, 1993, that's come through a lot of evolutions. Just to our services, if you look in the future, web services will still be a problem. If you learn about GIS, you have to learn web services. It's not hard, it's very easy to learn. Browser-side is becoming stronger, especially JavaScript. JavaScript is taking over because of the HTML 5. Superlight, Flex, variety of fading away. Mobile is becoming a pervasive kind of platform. There are so many smartphones now. On this kind of DTI, which is services and augmented reality for very research areas. Cloud GIS is a reality. It's becoming stronger and stronger. And we have more functions to deliver through the Cloud GIS. Not just functions, but also the contents. Today, ESR, we have this. We're also providing confidence. GIS becoming more dependent with the web environment. Our different components, server, client, mobile, we have many real-time features. 3D, more user-friendly, other things that we now talk about is our system network, the data things. This is one slide I borrowed from Jack's slide of this conference. GIS is being transformed. Today, Web GIS is clearly the trend to go. So here we go, all these kind of trends. Dancing with all these trends. A little bit on a little plug on my course. If you want to know more about Web GIS, learn the school technologies. You can take my course teaching Web GIS at Harvard and also at the MSGS program here. You can search me online, you can find my courses, see us. So with that, I'll